Black's Law Dictionary, 7th edition, page 1120. Unpublished opinion. An opinion that the court has specifically designated as not for publication. Court rules usually prohibit citing an unpublished opinion as authority. Such an opinion is considered binding on only the parties to the particular case in which it is issued. And in that spirit, I'd like to welcome you to Unpublished Opinions. This is our first episode, a new podcast. It is a new podcast, but is part of the Short Circuit family, and is put on by Short Circuit and the Center for Judicial Engagement at the Institute for Justice. I am Anthony Sanders, the director of the Center for Judicial Engagement, and I am the normal host, regular host of Short Circuit, the podcast. So on Short Circuit, we talk about recent cases from the federal courts of appeals, and that shapes our conversation. That comes from the viewpoint, of course, of people at the Institute for Justice. We also sometimes have specials where we do deep dives on recent authors, have them on, talk about their books, or we talk about certain goings-on in the law. But this podcast is going to be a little bit different. It is a more relaxed take on what's going on in the law and what people's opinions are in the law, which is why we're saying it is unpublished. So I want to be clear, though, that this is a bit of an experiment. We'll see how it goes. We are not going to be doing this every week like we do Short Circuit. So I want everyone who is a fan of Short Circuit to think this is not replacing in any way the Short Circuit you know and love, either the newsletter or the podcast. Those will keep going the same way. We'll keep talking about the federal courts of appeals, having occasional live episodes, all that good stuff. This is just a supplement to that, where we can give you some of our opinions, unpublished, about the law. And I am very excited to have on, for our very first episode, two familiar voices to fans of Short Circuit, Patrick Giacomo and Anya Bidwell. Welcome to both of you.
Hey, thank you.
Hey, I'm feeling very relaxed, consistent with this relaxed
Okay, well, format. Because you're in California, so that's not entirely surprising. But thank you, Anya. Everyone should understand that this is, as we call it, unpublished opinions. It will show up on your feed as unpublished opinions. But if you're like, that hokey thing they're doing, I don't want that. I just want my Short Circuit content. You can just skip right by. We will hold nothing against you if you don't click on that episode and instead just go to Short Circuit. That is perfectly fine. But if you want to stick around, see what the buzz is about, see the fuss, listen to the fuss, listen to some unpublished opinions, we're glad you're here. So our first subject, actually, we're not terribly scripted here, but we talked about a couple things that maybe we'll gossip on. Is going to be about unpublished opinions. But I want to make clear that we're not going to talk about unpublished opinions all the time, every episode. Now, you could start your own podcast called Unpublished Opinions, where all you do is talk about unpublished opinions, and that would be a super rad niche podcast, but that is not this podcast. But to start things off today,
if you tried, you'd be violating IJ's trademark. Don't violate IJ's trademark. This is our intellectual property.
We would appreciate you respecting our intellectual property, such as it is. And Patrick, I want you to tell us a little bit about your intellectual property and your opinions on unpublished opinions.
I'm a ginnam. I think unpublished opinions are terrible for several reasons. The first of which is that they're not unpublished, which is the most frustrating thing about the concept.
Right, but they used to be in olden days.
Sure, but we don't live in olden days anymore. And so the concept that, you know, perhaps there were too many cases being decided that the publishers and the old law books wouldn't be able to fit them in all the books, or there wasn't time to print them all, or whatever the original justification was, no longer exists anymore. And so every decision by a court is now published somewhere, usually on a website, and is available in most of the reporter services like Westlaw and Lexis. And so the, you know, kind of all of the historical arguments for viewing unpublished opinions with less importance as published opinions doesn't exist anymore, because you can get these opinions, you can read them, you can see the logic that was applied by the court in developing the law. And so there's no good reason that I've heard for the continued existence of unpublished opinions as a lesser form of non-precedential decision-making by courts.
What do you think of GVRs at the Supreme Court level?
What about them?
So are they a form
of... they're in the U.S. reports, right? So they're not even unpublished.
Exactly. You can cite those things. So here's where I began my distaste for unpublished opinion. So I started practicing in Michigan, and Michigan's court rules specifically say, you know, unpublished opinions are not precedential and they're disfavored, at least last I looked. And you were required, if you cited an unpublished opinion, to one, explain why you're citing it, which seemed always like an odd requirement, because hopefully you explain why you're citing all the cases you're citing. That's kind of the point of citing cases. But two, then you had to actually attach a copy of the opinion as an exhibit to your briefing, which is this, again, this is just insanity, because you're attaching a copy of, for instance, an unpublished Michigan Court of Appeals opinion to a brief that you're submitting to the Michigan Court of Appeals, which has the opinion on its servers where you got it, to print it and then attach it to a brief and resubmit it. And the whole thing just felt very silly. But setting that aside too, it just, so to me, is so disrespectful to the parties in the cases where courts essentially say, hey, I think this isn't important enough for us to publish, even though we're going to explain our position and you will be bound by it. It's not actually part of the larger law, which kind of, I guess, in the minds of some judges, gives them a sort of out to say, like, well, if I screwed this up, it's no big deal because I've only ruined this one case for these parties. And that none of this really passed the smell test for me.
It's interesting because it comes up in qualified immunity context, right? That case that qualified immunity community really knows, McCoy versus Alamo out of the Fifth Circuit, involved a prisoner being pepper sprayed for no reason. And one of the cases that the prisoner relied on to overcome qualified immunity involved punching, but that opinion was unpublished. So the court basically said, yes, you have this precedent, and maybe you could say that it put the official on notice, but the opinion is unpublished, and because it's unpublished, it doesn't qualify. And Judge Costa, in dissent, really called out the court on this, right? So it kind of basically saying this is just, you call it unpublished, and as a result, plaintiffs can't take advantage of this. What sense does it even make?
Yeah, and I think this issue in the clearly established test for qualified immunity and unpublished opinions kind of dovetail nicely, because both of them are sort of based on more or less a series of legal fictions about, hey, what is this opinion and what do people do with this opinion? And, oh, well, if it's unpublished, then no one's reading it. As if most people outside of the weirdos on this podcast and who listen to it aren't reading, you know, most of the decisions. We're not even reading most of the decisions in the federal reporters. And so with qualified immunity on the one hand and unpublished opinions on the other, there's this bizarre legal fiction that exists that assumes that, like, well, you know, if it's unpublished, then people aren't reading it. And implicitly, that means if it is published, people are reading it and it's providing notice. And none of this makes any sense. And everybody knows it, which is the frustrating thing about both qualified immunity and unpublished opinions.
I think really, there's two things going on here, one of which is really not relevant anymore, and that is the literal dissemination of the opinion, right? So it used to be, and but the other is the precedential value. So it used to be that if an opinion, let's say 19th century, if an opinion was not published, you literally would not know about that opinion unless you were a party to the case, or like the party to the case gave you their file or whatever, right? So, or maybe the judge himself remembered it and you could bring it up to him 2 years later as like, you know, remember that case, judge? This is like that case. Or, you know, there were some famous cases from early U.S. history we only know about because a newspaper wrote about them. Or like, there were jury, like what the jury did in some early case. So there I get, like, you can't cite that opinion. You can't cite it because there's nothing to cite to. Say you have your own personal copy, but it's not fair to the other side, right? That they don't have the copy. And that kind of is now gone by the by with electronic databases. And it has for a while.
Yeah, and I was going to say, I wonder when that actually did go out the window, because it was, you know, sometime between right now and the invention of the printing press, where like, you know, this, it became economical to copy and paste things. But certainly in the era of the internet, this is no longer a problem.
Why would the courts not publish opinions originally?
The thing was, it was right. These, like, say you look at these old cases. I mean, the U.S. Supreme Court has this, but there are other courts too. You look at these old cases and you look, there's a name in the actual reporter citation. That's because that is the individual who was the court reporter who actually published it, often privately in their own printing press, and, you know, sold copies of it. And if they thought a case came out, maybe they are at the courthouse and they were the person who wrote down the oral reading of the opinion and they thought it wasn't very interesting. Well, they just wouldn't publish it. And so,
like the actual person,
and this could be true for a trial level court or an appellate
judgment.
Court. And so it wasn't, it's like whether or not it's published wasn't the decision of the court. It's the decision of the court reporter. Now that still is true for federal district courts, right? Whether a federal district court opinion shows up in the West Reporter or not is West's decision. It's not sometimes.
And by the way, you can tell West to publish it.
Yeah.
If you feel strongly enough.
And and of course, district court opinions, as we know, but sometimes forget, lawyers know that they are not, quote, the law. They are not precedent. So like you can kind of get that set. Like there was this one case I needed a copy of for internal law firm reasons when I was in private practice. And it was from 1983, like our firm had been involved in it. And the only way I could get an actual copy of that was to go to the National Archives, like in South Chicago, and look in this old box for a copy of it, because it was before, you know, the electronic dockets had even started, let alone Westlaw or something like that. And so that's not that ancient, right? 1983. So
it is pretty ancient, Anthony.
I was alive then. I don't know. Right. Maybe
that's
not you
I'm
guys.
Saying.
It predates Anya and my. It predates Anya's and my existence.
So this, the whole idea of like published access, you know, is still pretty new. But I think what happened over the years is this idea of publication then kind of merged with precedent. And that leads to the funny business that appellate courts to do when they're like, okay, we're going to decide whether this is published or not. Not some Yahoo court reporter. I'm descended from a long line of court reporters, so I can call them Yahoos. And so that leads into the idea that you make what is law and what is not law. And then you have unpublished opinions where you don't spend much time on it. And so they're more sloppy. And so the Fifth Circuit can say, oh, that was one of those sloppy ones where we didn't try very hard. So, you know, if we had actually tried, maybe it would have been different. And so we're not going to say it's clearly established.
Yeah. And really on this point of the merger issue, it seems like, you know, there's obviously downsides with the historical version of it where the reporters themselves decided what went in things. But on the flip side, there were competing reporters. And so it might not be in, you know, Howell's trial or whatever, but it might be in you know, one of the other English reporters, for instance. And now that this has merged, it has become a mechanism that the courts can use to shield themselves, as opposed to one that was at least kind of neutrally put forward. And obviously under the old system, you didn't have the, well, I can do a bad job in this opinion because we'll just say it's unpublished, because you didn't know as the judge that it would be unpublished. And now today, you know, the courts kind of use this as an out, and it's never been particularly clear. And I have yet to hear kind of modern defense of unpublished opinions that doesn't ultimately boil down to like, well, you know, we're really busy and sometimes we're going to be kind of sloppy. And, you know, if we think a case isn't important, we're going to allow ourselves to be sloppy there. But we also can all think of examples where it seems at least like the courts have covered themselves by doing an unpublished opinion and hoping to make something less likely to get reversed on appeal or less likely for the Supreme Court to grant cert or something like that. Because
do you know,
the court use the mechanism.
Ahead.
That's it.
Do you know ahead of time if you're going to have an unpublished opinion or a published one? Because if you know ahead of time.
I never have.
No, like a judge, right? When the judge is writing an opinion, do they know ahead of time that they're going to make it published or unpublished? Because if you know that it's not unpublished, you could very well like swing more freely. Like there is one opinion that we are citing to in a Fifth Circuit case, and it's great in its language. It's basically accusing our defendant, who we're suing now, of being deliberately indifferent. And it's pretty much stating it as much. But it's an unpublished opinion. And I wonder whether the court actually felt comfortable saying what it did because it thought, oh, the opinion is not going to be published anyway, so we don't have to really worry about our language.
I don't know for a fact. I bet it depends on the court. The little I know and experience I had clerking is I think it usually is at conference that you know if it's like, I don't think you invest a lot of time writing amongst the judges on the panel and then we're like, we'll just make it unpublished. Although I bet that does happen. And maybe it happens more at the federal level.
Yeah. How is that related to the whole shadow docket discussion at the Supreme Court?
Well, as to what, I mean, I know it's related big time as to whether those are should be precedential. So for listeners' benefit, shadow docket are these basically anything the Supreme Court does where there's not oral argument. And
or full briefing, right?
Sometimes not even, often not full briefing, right. And often they're per curiam, so they're not signed by an individual author. And yet they do seem to be treated as full binding published authority. I think it's, it's similar issues. Although I would bring up, to take the devil advocate role here, which I have a little bit of sympathy for, if the only real justification, as Patrick said, is courts are super busy. And if something is more routine looking, maybe you get into it and it's not that routine, but it's routine looking. Okay. So that we don't just get super backed up because Congress is, not allotted enough judges or resources or whatever, or the state legislature, we're just going to have some of them be unpublished. And you know what? A lot of these are these dog catcher, or prisoner appeal cases really are pretty routine. And so we'll just spend less time on those and hope for the best. And, the other answer is everything is published. And so they're going to spend a lot more time on all of them. And then you have to wait 5 years for your decision. I don't know if there's a perfect answer there.
Yeah, I don't know. I question whether that's the actual choice being made or if it's just more of an excuse. Like, everybody's doing everybody in their profession is doing their job as best they can within the constraints of, there being 24 hours in a day and 7 days in a week. And so just like litigants couldn't go in and say like, oh, well, I think this case is less important as a lawyer, so I didn't really spend a lot of time on the briefing. That doesn't fly for us. So it shouldn't fly for the people whose job it is to judge what that briefing means in terms of the outcome of a case.
I mean, the flip side is it would just be a very different world is if no one case was precedential, right? So everything is kind of, and I know I've brought this up on Short Circuit before. So the old common law idea is every case is kind of part of the law. It's part of this tapestry of the law, but it's not necessarily like the latest case on a subject isn't treated like a statute, like we treat the latest Supreme Court case. Right. And so if we treated them, then they kind of would be all unpublished in the non-precedential sense, and yet they would still be part of the law. And I don't know, maybe a way to treat it today is to have these non-precedential unpublished appellate opinions, treat them as part of the law, but not, not like statutes. And that's kind of maybe what the federal courts do these days, because the federal courts, again, for listeners' benefit, changed the rules. It was about 15 years ago now that you can cite unpublished opinions. It's just they're not precedential, but they are evidence of the law.
Well, that's another weird thing too. And this goes back to my anecdote about the Michigan rules. It's like you have to jump through these silly hoops for citing unpublished opinions, but I could cite the Court of Appeals of Kansas's decision all day long without having to attach it and justify it, even though, you know, presumably a non-precedential decision by a panel of the Michigan Court of Appeals is more persuasive to another panel of the Michigan Court of Appeals than some random Kansas decision, which I can cite, you know, willy-nilly.
And that's because they might have the library downstairs because it's in the, you know, the West, whatever the regional reporter is for Kansas.
Definitely. That must be it. Because in my experience, you know, all the courts and their clerks are still pulling up the Shepherd's table of contents for their giant book supply and looking.
We're about to get an article published that I won't bore the listeners with. We just got it site checked, and the site checkers, I can tell, went to the actual printed reports. And this is from like the early 19th century. And we got a couple things wrong that are in Lexis. Like, we got them right from Lexis, but they checked them. So I will say there's some value to going to the paper still.
In what sense did they get them wrong, though? Did they get them wrong substantively?
This is the article I've talked about before about the origin of the phrase en banc. And we said that the first use of banc, B-A-N-C, in America was in a certain case. Turns out when you go to the original, it's B-A-N-K, which was like the colonial spelling. And so it got changed at some point in the modern edition. Like, some editor actually changed that.
You know, I've thought about this a little bit in the context of the sort of AI citation scandal that took place in the New York courts not too long ago. You know, and there it's obviously clear cut that what the problems were. Like, these are completely made up cases, and there was a bunch of other issues that arose around them. But I did have that thought as the court was talking about, well, what did you do to verify that this was an actual case? And I was thinking, man, I don't verify cases. If I pull a case off Westlaw, I don't then go find the reporter and make sure that it's, you know, and presumably, like, what you're talking about something very specific, and the word choice is incredibly important. But, you know, I've obviously, in clerking in particular, found examples where the paper book had like a different word choice, or there was a missing word that somehow got copied into the West online database or whatever.
Every once in a while, West or Lexis will leave out like the word not, which can be highly consequential in some cases.
Yeah. But, you know, at the same time, there's surely situations that you're never going to catch where the court's opinion was, you know, incorrectly put into the book. And there were certainly situations that I remember on the Michigan Court of, or the Michigan Supreme Court, where, you know, between the publication of the opinion and it being printed in the book, they made slight changes because there were, you know, grammatical errors or phrasing was awkward or things, just little things like that. And so presumably there are also instances where the opinion that the judges all agreed on by the time it gets printed in the reporter is, you know, a few words different from what it originally was.
But they don't all agree on that new, they don't re-vote to do that. Because I was through that process too as a clerk. It's like the Westlaw calls you up and says, I think this thing's a little wrong. And you check and it is wrong. But you don't re-conference on that.
Well, I'm talking about communicating with the reporter's office at the Michigan Supreme Court, where someone who's an arm of the court. And they're saying, like, okay, we're getting this ready for whatever we do to finalize it to be put in the book next year. And we're going to change this word. We're going to add this comma, whatever it is. But in any case, look, this is just a highly technical doctrine that should be extremely powerfully justified to continue, in my opinion, to continue going forward. Like, if there is some really good reason that we haven't touched on here today, the supporters of the existence of unpublished opinion should be out there explaining it and justifying it, because the historical reasons clearly make no sense anymore.
And I also think, though, that lawyers shouldn't, like, not cite cases because they're unpublished, right? They shouldn't be deterred by, oh, this is not precedential, so this is not as important, and maybe I'm not going to use this case. Lawyers should, like, full on, you know, go in and assume essentially that this is good law, right? And then let somebody else.
Yeah, although depending on your judge, because some judges probably do, you know, because it maybe just because it's a heuristic, it's easier for them. They skip over unpublished opinions.
I've had oral arguments in Michigan courts where the court says, hey, this is an unpublished opinion. You did not attach it. Therefore, we're not going to consider it. So either way, jump through all the hoops.
Still,
you need, jump through all the hoops you need to. But yeah, Anya's right. You should cite these
cases.
Don't
be deterred. Don't just assume that, you know, oh, it's going to get, stricken out or something.
Anya, when the revolution comes, I think everyone will feel safe to do that. But we might not be there yet.
We'll see. But look, while we're talking about, you know, pure technicalities, again, we can come back to the concept of qualified immunity, which to the audience, you know, just to remind you, essentially requires a plaintiff who's suing a government official for a constitutional violation to point to clearly established law. And the meaning of that has been in flux since 1982 when the Supreme Court announced the doctrine of qualified immunity in Harlow versus Fitzgerald. And more or less today, everyone agrees that it means an appellate decision from your jurisdiction, either from the U.S. Supreme Court or from the circuit court. And then, you know, how thinly you slice the salami is a whole different ballgame. But weirdly, over the last 10 years or so, the Supreme Court, in just a handful of its cases involving qualified immunity, I think seven of them, has had like some weird throwaway line that says, even if anything other than Supreme Court precedent can clearly establish the law, X. And so they haven't said...
Yeah, in Westby, it's not a throwaway line. In Westby, they're explicitly saying that we have never said whether circuit court case law constitutes, you know, is part of the clearly established analysis.
Yeah, and so I want to come back to that because that's just straight up wrong. But
it's a published opinion.
Judge Oldham in the Fifth Circuit, who's a very smart guy, he has a few times kind of made this point and recently did so in a case called Boyd versus McNamara, where a jailer was accused of excessive force and the panel ultimately said he didn't get qualified immunity, citing a bunch of circuit decisions. And Judge Oldham has a dissent in part here on this issue where he says, hey, you know, the Supreme Court's made this comment a bunch of times. And given that the court's never clearly established that anything other than its decisions are sufficient to satisfy qualified immunity, I don't think it's fair for us to expect police officers or other government workers to be able to sift through the sometimes inconsistent circuit decisions and figure out what the law might be. And so the problems right off the bat with this are, one is more pragmatic, which is like, if this is true, it will drastically increase the protections of qualified immunity. And to give you a concrete example, IJ has our constitutional GPA study, which is aimed at helping plaintiffs get past qualified immunity by putting together all the statements of clearly established law in the country and allowing people to easily find them. And in that process, our last publication, we had about 2,300 statements of clearly established law across all the circuits in the Supreme Court. And of all of those, only 125 are from the Supreme Court. So we're talking about 5%. So essentially, that means that qualified immunity is going to increase exponentially with only 5% of the current statements of clearly established law being sufficient if, you know, Judge Oldham's theory here is correct.
I mean, you say that about any body of precedent, which is really what qualified immunity is a body of precedent.
But to Oldham's defense, I think he's talking about exclusively... Right? Like he's basically saying you can't exclusively rely on Fifth Circuit precedent. He is saying that clearly established law must have a combination of at least of a Supreme Court precedent and the Fifth Circuit precedent. So it's not as he's saying you can only bring in Supreme Court stuff. He's saying you can't.
What does that mean, though?
Fifth Circuit stuff.
He talks about exclusively, but I think his point is you can't rely on the circuit court opinions. You have to have an anchor on the Supreme Court. No, what would they do? What good would the circuit court opinions be in the context?
But I mean, how specific does the Supreme Court need to be? Say it's a Fourth Amendment case. Is Map v. Ohio enough?
Well, that's kind of the problem with the whole test. That's the other piece of the test, and this is something that Judge Oldham cites, is like, oh, the Supreme Court's routinely said you can't rely on general statements of law. You have to be able to drill down to some level of specificity such that every reasonable officer would know beyond debate that the thing they're doing is unconstitutional. And finding those Supreme Court cases and applying them is going to be very difficult. But to the kind of merits of this technical argument, my reason for rejecting it is twofold. One is in the case called U.S. versus Lanier, which was actually a criminal case under the 242 criminal analog to 1983. The Supreme Court specifically said that you can rely on circuit courts to clearly establish the law, at least in that context, and the courts have otherwise treated those two things as identical. And the other is, in Harlow versus Fitzgerald itself, the Supreme Court drops a footnote when it talks about clearly established law for the first time and says, like, hey, we're not going to get into it, but as we have already explained, clearly established law is dictated by our decisions, the circuit decisions, and the decisions of the local district court. And so we've already kind of sheared it way back from Harlow itself. And it's very strange for the court to have been dropping this hint intermittently for the last decade. It's not in every Supreme Court case. It's only in like a handful. In fact, the latest statement was in a case called Rivas Villegas. And at the same day they decided that case, they decided another case called Taliqua. And there they didn't use that language. And so there's somebody or some bodies on the Supreme Court that keep inserting that into the decisions, and it's not clear why that's only happening intermittently and why the remainder of the court is voting, you know, to approve a decision when that language is in there, if they don't actually think, yeah, it should just be Supreme Court precedent.
I think that kind of points to a bigger problem with the clearly established test, and that fundamentally it's not just about what cases count, trial court, circuit court, Supreme Court. It's just what the notion of fair warning means, which is the test of qualified immunity, whether a reasonable official would have been fairly known that what they're about to do is unconstitutional. It's not clear why it can only be cases, right? Why can't a statute put somebody on notice? Or frankly, why can't a Supreme Court of a state Supreme Court put somebody on notice, right? So like what... Or why can't just obvious principles of decency can put somebody on notice? So this one thing that we're isolating here just reflects a general reluctance by the Supreme Court to actually deal with the meaning of the fair warning standard and the meaning of appropriate level of specificity. And frankly, lawyers are desperate for a court to actually, you know, lay down the law and say, okay, here's what, when we say clearly established law, here's what we mean. We see inconsistencies across the circuit courts on so many levels, including when they're going beyond precedent, right, into whether the particular official acted objectively and reasonably in light of clearly established law, which is an additional prong. So the entire clearly established test is in complete disarray. And makes sense. And that's just one example of it.
Yeah. And really to kind of, I think, close the loop on Judge Oldham's dissent here is like, I'm not sure what his bigger project is with this. I read this dissent and I see Judge Oldham smirking because he's a very smart man. And when he says things like, if all circuit precedent is fair game, then how is an officer supposed to choose in a dangerous split second moment which case to follow? He doesn't think that, you know, line level police officers are up to date on all of the statements of clearly established law, even by the Supreme Court. The whole thing, like I said earlier, is a legal fiction that, you know, among others, Joanna Schwartz has proven like, hey, this isn't how officers are trained. Police officers are trained on the general ideas and reasonableness and Tennessee versus Garner and Graham versus Connor and these sorts of things. No one really thinks that, you know, the sheriff's deputy who works at the jail has just been waiting for the Supreme Court opinion releases that morning and has been refreshing his screen to make sure that he's staying up to date on the most recent Supreme Court precedent. And that's true, of course, with circuit court decisions or any other court decisions, which makes the clearly established test into an ass. Like, no one thinks that it actually achieves what the Supreme Court pretends that it achieves, which is providing
notice. Cynic could say, he's trying to kind of surreptitiously point that out by, you know, saying,
That's what I'm conveying with the smirk is I think that in some sense, this is Judge Oldham having fun with the fact that this whole test is completely made up and everybody knows that whatever provides notice to government officials about the constitutionality of their actions, it's not what's published in the Federal Reporters.
Well, what is it, Patrick?
It's training, it's general concepts. And look, this all goes back to Pearson versus Ray, the previous standard in existence between 1967 and 1982. And there, they looked at officers' good faith and reasonableness. And so in reality, it had to do more with, you know, actual knowledge and intent and things like that, as opposed to today, where we pretend like clearly established law imports some sort of reasonableness.
But in fairness, I think when the court was thinking about the clearly established law as it was creating it, it thought of it not as it would provide this particular officer with information about what this officer should be doing. I think it was thinking about it more as a general proxy for what the law of the land is, right? That if something is, you know, in the opinion, that chances are it is clearly established out in that universe. I don't think they thought about it as specific officer knowing the law as much as, no, it's a representation of what the law is. And if they did think about that, then it is not clear why that proxy can only be judicial opinions rather than additional things, right? And Justice Stevens kind of gets to that in Hope versus Peltzer. But I do think it's a fair criticism to say, you know, as Joanna Schwartz does in the Qualified Immunity's Boldest Lie paper, that, you know, nobody reads those cases. It's a fair criticism. But I don't think that the court itself was actually thinking about, you know, police officers literally reading those opinions.
Yeah, that's the problem is that's not where things started, but that's where things have ended. And it's been because of this incremental need to constantly be patching the holes in the bottom of this terrible rowboat that they have, you know, ejected from the constitutional sailing ship. And we're in the position we're in today because they have just continued to go along with a very faulty premise and build it up. And you know, before we lose sight of the reality of the concepts like Anya just expressed of, oh, the state of the law and fair notice and all that, just, you know, to remind everyone, we're talking about, you know, government officials and whether they have sufficient notice to know that their actions were unconstitutional. There's no analogous protection for normal people who accidentally violate the criminal law. And so we don't have this sort of discussion if someone violates some technical statute that subjects them to 5 years in prison, because the law presumes knowledge of people who are just everyday people, whereas now with qualified immunity, it presumes ignorance of the people who are actually doing the duties of the government on a day-to-day basis.
Well, not only that, it's a huge exception. I mean, this we could go on a real tangent here, but it's a huge exception to the normal rules of civil litigation, where, right, in the civil, the Supreme Court has been very clear on this under federal law, under is from this case Jim Beam from 1991, I believe, 93, that if you are found civilly liable, or there's a rule that applies to your civil case and the court announces it, and it announces it for the first time, it still applies to you. Even though you didn't have like this, you know, quote, notice. That's just how civil litigation works, because of the somewhat of a fiction of the court is finding the law. It is not making the law when it comes to that type of case.
Thank you.
And yet.
I think we got to all thank Learned Hand. You know, it's he who was one of the first ones to express this idea of the chilling effect. Right. And like government officials not vigorously exercising their duties. And so he's talking about the need for some sort of a breathing room so the official is not chilled by the fear of litigation. The court,
which
considers
is a massive
illegal
exception to what all private parties, you know, take part in when they're talking about rules that might apply to them in a civil case, which is what qualified immunity cases are. They're civil cases. They're about a rule that's the Constitution, but that's what they are.
And I think the premise itself should be examined, because we're talking about the Constitution, which is putting in place limits on the government. And so I think at least it's a very colorable argument to say, hey, we should want to chill any government official who's walking close to the constitutional line. They're taking risks at that point. And that was what the early Supreme Court would say time and time again. They would say, hey, look, if you act in violation of the laws or the Constitution, you act at your own peril. That's what the Constitution means. And so now to say, like, well, you know, this would stop police or, you know, tax officials or bureaucrats from doing literally whatever they think they want to do because they might actually violate the Constitution. You're like, yes, exactly. Good.
This or at least it should be done through the Congress, not courts, right? Like, if you're worried about the chilling policy, then Congress should pass a statute, because that's what Congress does. You know, it thinks about policies. It shouldn't be up to courts to worry about chilling effects. I am sympathetic to chilling effects. I just don't think courts should be worrying about that.
I also question how chilling they really are. I don't think most officials are thinking about it in these terms. And as we all know, if and when they ever get sued, their whole defense is paid for by the government, provided by the government. And if you somehow are able to get damages, those are paid by the government. So the thought that, you know, some bureaucrat is really worried that you might sue them, it just rings hollow to me in most instances.
Well, when these courts are making rules, especially the Supreme Court, they're a body of actual individuals who have relationships with each other and will sign on to each other's opinions and not sign on to these others' opinions. And Anya, I know you have some thoughts about maybe how that works, at least at the Supreme Court. So please enlighten us.
Yeah, another thing that we've been thinking about, I suppose, as we were getting ready for this podcast, is just the way the Supreme Court generally operates. And we don't get to talk a lot about the Supreme Court on the Short Circuit podcast, although we will coming up, because we have a special Short Circuit episode on Stanford Supreme Court Clinic and the kind of Supreme Court cases that they do over there.
And we'll have our annual Supreme Court preview from UNC in September.
There you go. So we do get to talk about Supreme Court sometimes, but not generally speaking. So I wanted to talk a little bit about it here. And the thing that stood out to me from this term is how different the oral arguments this term were from any in recent memory. The justices were much more active. The questions were much more engaging. And the justices in general appeared much more prepared. I think one reason for that is actually this new change in the argument format, where after you're done with your oral arguments, justices actually get to ask additional lingering questions if they have them. But another reason for this, you know, enlivened Supreme Court, I think, is Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson and the contributions that she's making during the oral arguments. I'm reminded of Justice Byron White when he once said that once you get a new justice on the Supreme Court, you get an entirely new court. And at least during oral arguments, that very much how it feels. The way I see it, Justice Jackson is so active during oral arguments and so well prepared that it makes other justices, frankly, mm-hmm. raise their game. Numbers do bear this out. I looked at the SCOTUS blog data, and there seems to be like across the board increase in the justices' oral argument word counts when compared to last term. The justices spoke approximately 39,000 more words just in the first 27 arguments this term than they did in the first 3 months, really not just of previous term, but of any term going back to 2011.
But is that apples to apples? Because, like, although the last term, Breyer's last, his last term, that they had the same format, right, where they all can ask questions at the end? So that would be apples to apples?
Yes. The format basically began during the pandemic.
Yeah. It carried over. It carried over from COVID. So for those who don't know or don't remember, before COVID, it was just a complete free-for-all. Then during COVID, when the court was hearing arguments over the phone, the procedure they put in place was basically the Chief Justice would kind of moderate, and he would go, in order of seniority, through the court, and the litigants would interact with one justice at a time for 2 or 3 minutes.
And Patrick, you had some experience with this.
Yeah. So when I argued our case, Brownback versus King, it was like this. It was just over a speakerphone, and the chief would start by asking his questions, and then he would ask Justice Thomas, "Do you have any questions?" And so on and so forth, all the
and
way
down.
And
that's when Justice Thomas started asking regular questions. That's another difference. Now Thomas is relatively active on the bench.
Yeah, that was going to be my observation was, you know, so I got questions from Justice Thomas, who historically, you know, had been seen as kind of a silent justice at oral arguments. And then after COVID and the court started hearing cases again, they went back to the free-for-all argument time. And then at the end, they would add this, "Does anyone have any more questions?" kind of hybrid approach to what had happened during COVID. And for whatever reason, I think both in terms of the actual, you know, main argument section and at the end, like Justice Thomas has continued asking questions at a much higher rate than he ever had historically. And so there's definitely been a big shift in the way that this current court deals with argument, and it has resulted in things being a lot more active.
But especially this term, I recommend everyone go and listen to oral arguments from this term. They just feel qualitatively different. There is a better energy. Gonzalez versus Google, Talevsky, Merrill versus Milligan, Students for Fair Admissions, Moore versus Harper. Go listen to any of those cases, and there is just more oomph in justices' questions. And it is this year, not the year before. So because of that, I'm attributing a chunk of it to Ketanji Brown Jackson.
So I think a big part of that is Justice Jackson and her questioning. I think another big part of it is the other part of the new court, which is Justice Breyer is no longer there. So as we all know, bless his heart, Justice Breyer would ask questions in his own way. They would often be rather long. They would have these absurd hypotheticals. You guys can, listeners, if you want, and you haven't seen it before, you can go on YouTube to see cartoons about his hypotheticals, and they were kind of a little extended sometimes. And if you take that away and you put a very different type of questioner, Justice Jackson, on there, it's not
dynamic
just like one ninth of the court. It's in a way, you know, you got to subtract out that. And Breyer was, you know, he was one of the biggest presences in the questioning because he had this kind of odd way. I don't know if it was good or bad. I mean, it was intimidating to a lot of lawyers how he would ask those hypotheticals.
It was. But I appreciate what he did. I think he was genuinely trying to figure things out, right? He didn't treat oral argument as mere formality where, you know, as frankly Justice Thomas did for a while, where he said, you know, all the arguments are made in the briefs. We don't need to be torturing these poor lawyers, right? Breyer didn't look at it that way. He very much looked at it as, here I am, help me think this through, right? And sometimes his manner would be extremely intimidating, I agree. But I think in good faith, he was just sitting there dealing with the issues and trying to understand the arguments.
Well, and he also did have a way of trying, I think, maybe it's colored by some of the cases where I more carefully listened to the argument, but he was trying to do a little bit of gotcha, which a lot of judges do. I'm not saying it's a bad thing at all, but he was trying.
Are you talking about Justice Breyer or Justice Alito?
Justice Alito has his own way of gotcha, which is very much a game of gotcha, but it's different. So I think some of that, you know, that putting someone on edge, knowing you are a target. But he's got, you know, he has this Columbo thing, Justice Breyer, like, yeah, ask his lying hypothetical to put you off guard and then maybe come back to it.
But then
what about this? What, how can you be saying that? He had this, you know, kind of way of coming around the back. And other justices,
true,
I think, are, you know, have the more direct style that most people are more used to.
Yes, and Justice Jackson, she has very much of a direct style, but she really goes in depth with her questions. And that's not just, you know, her engaging with the advocates, it's also her engaging with the rest of the court, right? And kind of expressing his view, her view, in as clear terms as possible. And I'm thinking of Students for Fair Admissions case as an example, where she asked about essays, right? And whether students would have an opportunity to discuss race in that format. And obviously, Chief Justice Roberts heard her, because then in the opinion itself, he specifically says, you know, nothing here should be construed as prohibiting universities from considering applicants' discussion of how race affected their life. So it's a way for Justice Jackson to also explain herself as clearly as possible and as early as possible to other justices.
And so I like that, because it shows that the with Justice Breyer, the vote would have been the same. But even though it's a different justice in the dissent, the majority opinion is perhaps written a bit differently.
A bit differently in a very important way. Yes. Oh, you had some sort of a story, though, to tell us about Justice White.
Oh.
Anthony?
Yeah, so... it's just an anecdote. So Justice White, listeners may know, what played in the NFL.
Yeah. What was his nickname?
Well, Wizard White.
White. Yeah.
White. And I just have two funny anecdotes about that. One is, when he passed away, I was in law school and I was watching SportsCenter. And like in the morning, getting ready for going to law school, and the presenter of SportsCenter is talking about how this guy has passed away, and talking about his football career and, you know, what he did in his football career, both in college and in the NFL. And then at the very end, she says, "And he was a U.S. Supreme Court justice for 31 years."
Just a little thingy to add.
So I thought, for the SportsCenter audience, that was kind of
funny. Was considering cutting it, but put it in last minute.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. You got to know your audience.
So, and the other is that, I guess, from what I've heard, he wasn't like talking about football all the time on the court. You know, he was talking about law or whatever, but he wouldn't play up football.
Justice Kavanaugh, are you listening? Can't be talking about basketball all the time. Come on.
One other thing I did want to bring up about the new court is, I think we won't know a lot, and still don't know, both with Justice Jackson and Justice Barrett, the newest members of the court. You know, a big impact for a new member is what cases they take. Right. So we don't have the cases that Justice Breyer would vote yes on, which you only need four for. And now we have Justice Jackson. And of course, there's going to be a difference there in all kinds of areas of the law, not just, you know, the real hot button ones. And that's going to take some time to play out. But it is definitely an impact. And so that's part of what the whole new court you get, because that's just 25% of a case being taken. And so that is going to have knock-on effects.
For example, questions of criminal justice reform, right? Something that we know Justice Jackson is has thought quite a bit about. So it'll be interesting to see if there is an increase in of those types of cases on the docket.
Well, time will tell. And we have Supreme Court term starting soon, as you will hear in our short court Supreme Court preview coming up. Any parting thoughts for our audience? Unpublished opinions of either of you?
Don't be afraid of unpublished opinions, people. That's all I'm saying.
Either the podcast or the actual opinions.
There you go.
Unbind your opinions. Doesn't matter if they're published or not. And let them be read.
Yes. And tune in to listen to Unpublished Opinions. Don't be afraid of us.
That's right. Well, until next time, and I have no idea when there will be a next time, thank you for sticking with us and giving this a test drive. Thank you very much to Panya, Anya, and Patrick for joining me today. And we'll see you, or we'll talk with you on the next Short Circuit. So I hope our listeners at least stick around for that. And until next time, these are just like our unpublished opinions, man.
Think about better transitions, okay?
Okay, I'm gonna cut this part out because I haven't thought of a good send-off.
Parting line. What's your parting line?
I don't want it to be get engaged.
I thought you were saying unbind your pages and let them be read.
Let your pages run free. Let your opinions run free?
No.
Don't let your opinions be unpublished.
That's not very catchy.